Native Americans have been an important pillar in the successes of American society in the last couple of centuries. Squanto was the Native American chief that helped the Pilgrims survive their first couple of years in America. Sacagawea helped lead Lewis and Clark through their expedition of the unexplored Western America, and Jim Thorpe was the first ever Native American to win an Olympic gold medal, who also happened to be the first president of the NFL. Up until the early 60s, Native Americans have been heavily ridiculed by the American population despite how much they influenced their way of life, and were forced into a society they did not want a part in. Since 1825, Native Americans lost 95% of their reservation lands, and most of the natives who previously lived on the lands went to American cities or deeper into Native reservations. In the early 1950s, Congress passed the Relocation Act of 1956, which resulted in as many as 750,000 American Indians migrating to cities. This act was implemented to encourage and provide support for American Indians to find jobs in cities and improve their lives from the poverty-ridden reservations. This fueled the resistance of American Indians against the forced transition into the modern world. In this modern world, they faced high unemployment, slum housing, and racist treatment. They also fought for the treaty rights and the reclamation of tribal land. This invisible barrier between Native life and modern living led to many major issues among the urban Native Americans. This form of unwanted integration carried through for more than a decade after. From 1963 to 1964, the United States government terminated recognition of more than 100 tribes and bands as sovereign dependent nations with the House Concurrent Resolution No. 108. The tribes would now be under U.S. law, and they would not have the right to govern their own people. Of course, tensions rose in the American Indian population, and AIM, or the American Indian Movement, was founded in 1968 to protect Native American rights and stop harassment by police. The organization was founded by Dennis Banks and Clyde Belcourt, and represented all 7 major Native American tribes. The organization is best known for the occupation of Alcatraz from November 1969 to June 1971. It was more of a symbolic and public awareness action, and AIM wanted to secure a victory for their people who had been oppressed for so long. From November 20th, 1969 to June 11th, 1971, Native Americans took over and held Alcatraz Island as Indian land. The occupation of Alcatraz was led by the Native American group Indians of All Tribes, or AIT for short. The takeover lasted 14 months and ended when the Indians were forcibly removed by the federal government. Indians of All Tribes claimed the island by citing the Treaty of Fort Laramie from 1868 between the U.S. and the Sioux. The treaty returned all retired, abandoned, and out-of-use federal lands to Native peoples. When Alcatraz Penitentiary closed in 1963, the U.S. declared the island as surplus federal property. Throughout the decade, several small groups consisting of only a few dozen supporters made attempts to occupy the island, but were shut down by the Coast Guard. On November 20th, 1969, American Indians again landed on Alcatraz, despite an attempted Coast Guard blockade. The 89 Indians that took over Alcatraz included students, married couples, and 6 children. To announce their action to the world, the dissidents issued the Alcatraz Proclamation. The occupiers cited treatment under the Indian Termination Policy as the reason for taking over. They also accused the U.S. of breaking numerous Indian treaties. The IAT said they took over the island to build a Native American study center, spiritual center, an ecology center, and an American Indian museum. The following is an excerpt from a letter that Richard Oakes, one of the leaders of the occupation, originally sent to the San Francisco Department of the Interior, that would later be passed to Congress on behalf of Mr. Oakes. We invite the United States to acknowledge the justice of our claim. The choice now lies with the leaders of the American government, to use violence upon us as before to remove us from our Great Spirit's land, or to institute a real change in its dealing with the American Indian. We do not fear your threat to charge us with crimes on our land. We and all other oppressed peoples would welcome the spectacle of proof before the world of your title by genocide. Nevertheless, we seek peace. This letter spoke with such power that it began to draw people together to support the Indian movement after the recognition of the countless violations that the Native people had faced. People such as John Trudell made daily radio broadcasts from the island about the activities going on there, which persuaded people to look towards peace as a solution. The rock band Creedence Clearwater Revival even donated $15,000 for a boat as a method of safe passage from the island to the mainland. However, tragedy for the movement struck in January 1970 when 13-year-old Yvonne Oakes fell to her death. The Oakes family left Alcatraz, saying they didn't have the heart for it anymore. Some original occupants left to return to school, as many were off from college for the summer. New occupants soon came to the island, but several had drug addictions. People from San Francisco's drug and hippie culture joined them until non-Indians were prohibited from staying overnight. Left without power, fresh water, and with public sympathy and support declining, occupants began leaving the island. On June 11, 1971, a large force of government officers removed the last 15 people from Alcatraz. The occupation of Alcatraz brought international attention to the plight of the native peoples in the U.S. It also sparked more than 200 instances of civil disobedience among native people in the coming decades. Unfortunately, the Native Americans could not permanently reclaim the island because a treaty only allowed reclaiming Indian territory adjacent to where the treaty took place. After the protests at Alcatraz, the leader and major Mohawk activist, Richard Oakes, was shot and killed, and the FBI and other agencies soon targeted AIM. In October of 1972, the Trail of Broken Treaties began. Sponsored by seven Native American groups, including AIM, a 20-point paper was created and moved the largest Native American protest to Washington, D.C., stopping by cities to read the document. When they arrived in Washington, the Nixon administration refused to negotiate, and angry protesters started vandalizing the Department of Internal Affairs headquarters. After a week of confrontation, the Nixon administration finally started negotiations, even giving some concessions. The 20-point paper initially made to get sovereignty for Native reservation and guarantee Native rights only succeeded in getting some of the rights for Native Americans. Despite this victory, anti-Indian legislation continued to pass. Due to this, a protest called the Longest Walk was organized. This walk protested all 11 not yet repealed anti-Indian legislations. The protest started at Alcatraz Island and went to San Francisco Bay and all the way to the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. 2,000 people volunteered for the 3,000-mile walk, having a sacred tobacco pipe lit for the whole protest. Upon arriving in Washington, D.C., the protesters stayed for a week to ensure their voices were heard. The walk was considered to be successful at bringing attention to several issues, including environmental rights and protection of sacred sites, but many more attempts were needed in order to force Congress to satisfy the needs of the protesters.